Good morning and welcome to our live stream worship at Joy. I'm Pastor Laura and I'm so glad you're with us this morning. Today is a special day because towards the end of our worship service, you will get the opportunity to meet our new youth director, Nick Nally, and his wife, Holly. We are so excited to welcome them to our Joy family. So you can look forward to that later in the service. But for now, please join us as we praise our Lord in song. Wherever you are, feel free to sing loud and proud.
Thank you. in me dwelling, and I with thee one. High King of heaven, victory won, may I reach heaven's joy, O bright and sun. My vision, O ruler of all, thou and thou only, first in my heart, my King of heaven, my treasure thou art.
O heaven's bright sun, come walk with us as you dig your son Paul. We need your presence. Like Paul, we are sinners. We have persecuted others through our thoughts, words, actions, and privilege.
Good and gracious God, accompany us on this journey. Break open our hearts and minds. We are standing in your light, and our hearts are wide open.
Teacher, help us to see with new eyes, open our ears to hear the voices that have been silenced in our world. Have your way here in our hearts, in our lives, and in this place.
My great Father, give us the wisdom and strength to fight injustice and bring light to the darkness. Stir in our hearts a passion to love our neighbors as ourselves, so that all people can live in peace.
We surrender all to you, O Lord, and pray that you use us to shine your light in this world.
Amen.
Hey, good morning, Joy. At this time, what we do every week, which we love to do, is simply share the peace with one another. Because here at Joy Lutheran Church, we believe somehow God's peace can actually pass through us to the people around us. And there's a very good chance right now somebody who's watching this or maybe somebody who's sitting next to you just needs a moment of peace. So what we do is real simple. I say the peace of the Lord be with you always. At home, please respond and also with you. And then we turn to our neighbors and simply say peace, or we type it in the comments section alone. The peace of the Lord be with you always. Let's take a moment to share that peace with the people around us right now. And while we're doing that and wrapping that up, I want to take a moment to share some of the announcements with what's going on at Joy Lutheran Church in the upcoming weeks. First of all, as always, I want to point you to our Connect page. It's on the screen right now. It's a way to learn about everything that's going on throughout the week when we're not sitting here in the worship service telling you. So go to the Connect page. It can tell you how to connect with other ministries, submit prayer requests. Just stop by the website and check that out, and you can find everything that's going on in the life of the church. One of the things that's coming up on 6/25, June 25th, between 2 and 6 p.m. is a blood drive. If you are interested in contributing to the blood pool that we need here in our country right now in our area, we invite you to show up for the blood drive. All social distancing protocols will be honored. There will be an RV out in the parking lot, and they will take care of you to make sure that everything is done in a way that honors social distancing and protects your health. The other thing I wanted to tell you about is today, right after church, in our Joy Facebook group, or you've received the email already, there is a link to the info meeting Zoom call. This is an opportunity for you. You've been emailed the budget already to take a look at the budget and then to show up to the meeting and ask questions of the leadership that will be there. So if you would like to participate, right around 11:15 after the service, the Zoom link, you can click on that. And we will have our team ready to answer any of your questions. Also, let's not forget Flat Jesus right here behind me. If you've got that, been emailed that, or would like that, let us know. What we're doing now, we've done this every summer, is we take Flat Jesus, we cut them out, we color them, and we take them with us wherever we go, whether we're sitting inside or in the backyard or starting to go to other places and see people. So if you would like to, take your Flat Jesus with you, snap a selfie with Jesus, and then you can post it on your Facebook page or our Joy Facebook group. Joy has a vision to intentionally include the people that we have unintentionally excluded. And through the years of discernment and conversation, Joy Lutheran Church feels called to intentionally include young adults, differently abled, and the LGBTQ community. Seeing how it's Pride Month for the LGBTQ community, with the vision team and council's blessing, we're adding a welcome statement that in so many ways names who we are and how we want to be known as a church. But it does it with so much clarity, I would like to read it to you right now. Joy intentionally welcomes and includes all people fully into the faith community, regardless of lifestyle, sexual orientation, gender identity or expression, race, ethnicity, religious background journey, physical or mental ability, education, socioeconomic or marital status, age, and political affiliation. Now, some are you going to say, that's a really, really long statement. Who's going to memorize that statement? And the answer is zero. But I will tell you this, for some of the people listed on that welcome statement, they're going to show up to see if they are identified in it. And if they can find themselves identified there, they will feel welcome into the life of this church. So with clarity, that's our welcome statement we're adding to the website in the next day or two. I want to thank the entire vision team, but especially the intentional inclusivity team that took the time to develop this welcome statement. And now I'm going to turn it over to Laura.
Thanks, Pastor Mark. Also, as part of this goal team, we have updated our statements regarding same-sex, same-gender marriages in our facility and have also updated our marriage guidebook. We welcome all LGBTQIA+ couples into our congregation, however you identify, and we have clergy that are pleased to perform your marriages inside or outside of our church building. I'd like to thank the LGBTQIA+ goal team for their thoughtful work on the intentional inclusivity of this community, helping us to live out our value of accepting each person as they are. And now I'd like to invite all of the kids to come closer to the screen for a children's message by Miss Christina.
Hi, Joy Kids. Today we're going to be talking about a guy from the Bible called Paul. Now, what's really interesting about Paul is he starts off thinking of Christians as one way and one thing, but then God helps him see Christians in a completely new way. Now, that's kind of a hard concept for me to think about. So when I think about it, I come over here to my trusty Disney pin board, and I take out one of my favorite pins. Now, this pin comes from my Ursula collection. And you're looking at me right now like, but Christina, look at that picture. That is not Ursula. You crazy. But if I hold my pin in a different way, oh, there's Ursula. See, Ursula, not Ursula. Ursula, not Ursula. What? This is what you call a holographic pin. So it has two images in the same pin, but it just matters how you look at it to see the image you want to see. It's really cool. It makes me feel a little magical. So it reminds me that sometimes what we see, we need to change our point of view to see what God sees. What we see, what God sees. What we see, what God sees. So that kind of reminds me of how Paul saw Christians one way and God changed him to see them another way. So can you pray with me, please? Dear God, please help me see things the way you want me to see them and not just what I see them as at first. Amen. Bye, guys.
I wonder sometimes if I had not been so wretched, if God still would have used me in such a powerful way. Of course, Back then, I didn't know I was so pitiful, but I wasn't always the man that you see before you today. I was born in Tarsus, a city of culture and education. My parents were rich, which afforded us Roman citizenship, as were many of the others in Tarsus. But I was never going to go to a school in Tarsus, no. My parents were good, conservative Jews. I was going to Jerusalem to study with Gamaliel, the greatest rabbi in all of Israel. When I was, I guess, 14, I left my parents' home and moved to Jerusalem. Once there, I spent every waking moment following my rabbi. I wanted to be exactly like him. I wanted to know what he knew. I wanted to do what he did. Eventually, I joined the Pharisees. We were the leaders, the lawyers, the keepers of the Jewish law and its customs. And we had the respect, and we had the power. It was during my 30s that there was this movement called The Way. Some of my blue-collar brothers up in the Sea of Galilee were talking about and spreading rumors that the Messiah, our Messiah, had returned. At first, we ignored this band of fishermen, but their followers were becoming a problem, converting all kinds of people. They were growing and speaking out against Moses and the law and the temple. It was blasphemy. I couldn't have it, so I went after them. We had to eradicate this rebellion against God. I was passionate. I just wasn't passionate for the right things. I can close my eyes and still see him. Stephen. A man named Stephen. I would say that I was jealous of him, but it was more than that. He was filled with this grace and peace that I could not comprehend. I know now it was Jesus living inside of him. Stephen was a threat, and I manipulated the events around his death. I didn't kill him, not by my own hands, but they're stained with his blood all the same. Certainly, I was a great Jew, but that had nothing to do with a relationship with God. I was in love with a God who we would worship from afar. To tell you the truth, I was in love with a power that my position gave me. Looking back, I can see how my education and my position could have been used by the disciples for Jesus. But first, I had to get to know him. I had to get to know Jesus. Thank goodness he loved me even before I found this purpose, but I'm getting ahead of myself. It just didn't happen the way you might have expected it to. Jesus had talked to me many times over the years, but never like the first time. The light, and then the darkness. I remember the light so vividly, like lightning right in front of my nose. My senses didn't quite know what to make of it. It was like touching something completely unfamiliar. My senses, I didn't expect to meet Jesus on the road to Damascus. It was terrifying to hear my name being spoken by a man in white with eyes, a blazing fire. Saul, Saul, why do you persecute me? So I said, who are you, Lord? And I was struck with the words that came next. I am Jesus, whom you are persecuting. The men I was traveling with could hear what was being said and were speechless as I fell to the ground. They remained motionless as I began to cry and did not understand why. When I stood, I was blind. That day, I became a son of the king. For 3 days, I was blind. Every day I prayed and fasted. I was grieved. How could I have been so wrong? How could I have done all those wrongs? I had the education. How could I not have known better? Jesus used that time to tear down who I thought I was and began to create who he wanted me to be. The intense guilt was overwhelming, but every day there was a little more depth of Jesus' love for me and the forgiveness that comes with that. When I could see again, I went to Arabia. I needed to be alone to get to know Jesus. I had so much education and training, but somehow I missed the most important part of the story. I spent days poring over the scriptures, reread Isaiah and Micah, and I wept as I realized that the truth had been there all along. I spent time wrestling with how Jewish laws and customs fit into the fulfillment of the scriptures. I wanted to know how Jesus could forgive me. How he could not only forgive me, but love me. I spent 14 years walking on dirt paths, kicking stones, and thinking about how my past might be useful. I wanted to use my intellect again, but this time for Jesus.
A kindergarten teacher once asked her class, "What do you want to be when you grow up?" Susie was the first to answer. She said, "I'll tell you what, when I grow up, I want to be rich. I want to drive around town in my fancy sports car. I want to live in my $45 million mansion. I want to spend summers in Paris and winters on the beaches in Greece." Teacher didn't know what to say, so she asked again to the other students, "What do you want to be when you grow up?" And one person said, "I want to be married to Susie." Now, when I was 5 years old and somebody asked that question, you will never guess what I wanted to be when I wanted to grow up, when I grew up. I wanted to be a sewer repairman. Now, let me explain why I wanted to be a sewer repairman. One day on the block where we lived in Indiana, a street crew showed up to repair the sewer. As a young boy, they allowed me to walk over and watch what they do, and every single day I stood and watched them repair the sewer. And by the time they were done, I knew exactly what you had to do to repair a sewer, and I told my mom I'm going to be a sewer repairman until I realized what sewers are used for, and then never wanted to do that again. Now, through the years, I've been a paper boy delivering papers, a vacuum cleaner salesman, a summer camp cook, a software developer, and most recently, for the past 15 years, a pastor. But lately, I find myself wanting to be something else, something I never expected. I find myself wanting to be right. I want to be right more than anything else. When someone says something wrong, I just feel the need to correct them and say what's right. I want to be right when it comes to politics. I want to be right when it comes to my understanding of issues like racism, abortion, and even the pandemic. I want to be right when it comes to our church welcoming all the people I just mentioned in our welcome statement. And this is kind of new. I've never felt this need to be right before. Not like I do now. And then now in the past, I was more open and patient to different opinions and thoughts. But now my patience is kind of run thin. And I don't think I'm the only one experiencing this. Maybe it's because of the pandemic. Maybe it's because we've been forced to kind of look at social media now for 12 weeks. But civil conversations and open dialogue have been completely replaced with bantering back and forth between who's right and who's wrong. Like never before, I see it played out nearly every conversation on social media and even in-person conversations with a zealousness like I've never witnessed before. People are putting an amazing amount of effort making sure people know they are right and others are wrong. Now, here's my fear. I fear we are becoming what the Bible refers to as zealots, having this like fanatical and uncompromising pursuit of certain religious, political, or other ideas. So what's next? What's next as this tension in our country and community rises and family relationships and friendships are strained? What's next? The Bible does have the story of someone who was a zealot, someone with this fanatical and uncompromising pursuit of his religious ideologies. His name was Saul. He's the person we saw in the drama earlier. And I doubt when he was five, if someone asked him, "What do you want to be when you grow up, Saul?" I doubt he would say, "I want to be the person who persecutes and puts to death people who don't follow God's law." But that's exactly who he became. His zealous pursuit of being right when it came to God's law created a person who persecuted people he thought were wrong. So I think his story is timely for us today. So we're going to meet Saul. We're going to talk about his story, and we're going to see what happened when he encountered Jesus on the road. So sometime after the very first Easter, one of Jesus' disciples named Stephen was preaching to his Jewish audience. Now, the Jewish audience was less than receptive, and he completely lost his cool. He lost his patience. He accused them of, listen to this, being stiff-necked and stubborn. He reminded them how they persecuted all the prophets. He declared them guilty of betraying and killing Jesus. And if that were enough, not enough, he pushed the Pharisees' hot button when he said, "You who have received the law from God that was given through angels, but have not even obeyed it." The crowd attacked and stoned Stephen. They killed him. Guess who was quietly watching from the sidelines and allowed this all to happen? Saul. After Stephen's rant against the Jews, Saul went on a rampage. With the support of his superiors, he set off for Damascus to persecute anyone who was a follower of Jesus. And we're going to pick Saul up on the road to Damascus. Here we go. Acts 9, chapter verses 3 through 9. As he neared Damascus on his journey, suddenly a light from heaven flashed around him. He fell to the ground and heard a voice say to him, "Saul, Saul, why do you persecute me? Who are you, Lord?" Saul answered, "I am Jesus whom you are persecuting. Now get up and go into the city and you will be told what you must do." The men traveling with Saul stood there speechless. They heard the sound but did not see anyone. Saul got up from the ground. But when he opened his eyes, he could see nothing. So they led him by the hand into Damascus. For 3 days he was blind and did not eat or drink anything. Saul had begun this journey to persecute Christians, and instead he encounters Christ. And the next step to becoming who Christ wanted Saul to be was sacrifice. He wanted Saul to sacrifice. Saul's sight was sacrificed in this encounter with Jesus. He could no longer see the Christians that he persecuted, and his goal to persecute Christians was sacrificed. He could not persecute what he could not see. In just a matter of a few seconds, Saul's entire life changed when his sight was sacrificed. So now he sits there, drowning in his struggle and uncertainty. He pondered all the wrong he had done and who he had become. So what's next in these difficult times for us? What can we learn from Saul? When we have all this tension between being right and wrong and who's right and who's wrong, maybe we have to be like Saul. Maybe we have to sacrifice our zealous pursuit of being right so that our communities are not destroyed. Because I'll tell you what, I see this happening everywhere, in families, in churches, in our country. There's this division happening more and more, and the gap is growing wider as people fight to be right and tell others they are wrong. Maybe we need to sacrifice that. Maybe we need a couple days where we don't see anything but ourselves and our own thoughts. See, I believe, don't get me wrong here, I believe God will reveal what is right or what is wrong, but it will not come at the expense of dividing the body of Christ. I want to say that one more time. I believe God will reveal what is right and what is wrong, but it will not come at the cost of dividing the body of Christ. I find it interesting here that Jesus asked Saul, "Why do you persecute me?" Now, to the best of my knowledge, this is the first time Saul has encountered the risen Lord. I never hear that he saw Jesus prior to this. And Jesus asked this question, like, "Saul, why are you persecuting me?" It almost sounds like they've had exchanges before and Saul's been on the hunt for Jesus. Maybe the reason Jesus asked that question is because of the way he viewed his followers. They were more than just members of a congregation. These people were literally the body of Christ. They were Christ's hands and feet on earth while he was with his Father in heaven. "Why do you persecute me, Saul?" is another way of saying, why do you persecute the body of Christ? Why do you persecute me? Maybe this question that Christ asked Saul is a question for us as well. Maybe like Saul, we must sacrifice our zealous pursuit of being right for the sake of the body, because every time we get in these arguments of right and wrong and go to bat and our anger and say things to one another, maybe when we do that, we are actually persecuting the body of Christ. And again, like I said a few minutes ago, I believe God will reveal what is right and wrong, but it will not come at the expense of dividing the body of Christ. So back to the story. Christ leaves Saul to sit in silence. And Christ reaches out to a man named Ananias and asks the unthinkable of Ananias. In Damascus, there was a disciple named Ananias. The Lord called to him in a vision, "Ananias." "Yes, Lord." The Lord told him, "Go to the house of Judas on Straight Street and ask for a man from Tarsus named Saul, for he is praying. In a vision, he has seen a man named Ananias come and place his hands on him to restore his sight." "Lord," Ananias answered, "I have heard many reports about this man and all the harm he has done to your holy people in Jerusalem. And he has come here with authority from the chief priest to arrest all who call on your name." Do you see what Ananias is doing? He's literally debating with the Lord. It's like, "Lord, I think you're wrong and I think I'm right. I think that this person you want me to go see, this person named Saul, he persecutes people like me. He's going to harm me, Lord. See, Lord, I know you think you're right, Lord, but I'm right. I can't go do it." See, but Ananias is still becoming the person God has in mind. And Ananias has to sacrifice his prejudice and fear, his preconceived notions based on good authority and facts. He had to sacrifice his need to be right about Saul so God could do what God intended to do. See, here's what I learned from that. Is if we sacrifice our pride and prejudice towards others, it allows us to enter into relationships that God wants us to be in. With the very people who will help us become the people God has in mind, to be in community where God will reveal right and wrong. To make a long story short, Ananias did go. But the Lord said to Ananias, "Go. This man is," listen to this, this is Saul, "the one who persecuted Christians, the one who had to be right." He says, "This man is my chosen instrument to proclaim my name to the Gentiles and their kings and to the people of Israel. I will show him how much he must suffer for my name." Then Ananias went to the house and entered it, and he placed his hands on Saul, and he said, "Brother Saul, the Lord Jesus, who appeared to you on the road as you were coming here, has sent me so that you may see again and be filled with the Holy Spirit." Immediately, something like scales fell from Saul's eyes, and he could see again. He got up and he was baptized, and after taking some food, he regained his strength. Saul spent several days with the disciples in Damascus. You have two people here who, if they were having an argument on Facebook or some social media, I guarantee Ananias would have been slamming Saul left and right, and Saul would be posting videos on how the Christians were bad for Jerusalem and for the Jews, and they would go back and forth and back and forth. But God chose Saul to be a voice to proclaim the good news of Jesus to the Gentiles. And that only happened because Ananias sacrificed his prejudice, his fear, and his anger against Paul. And when Ananias sacrificed his fear and prejudice towards Saul, he found he had the capacity to call Saul brother. He called him brother. And it was at this moment Saul's sight returned. He no longer saw an enemy. He saw a brother. The very person he would have seen as an enemy, somebody who was wrong 3 days before, he now saw as a brother. A lot of times when we talk about this scripture, we say that Saul, who became Paul after this, had a conversion experience on the road to Damascus. But I read something that challenged that. It didn't happen on the road to Damascus when he lost his sight. It happened the second his enemy called him brother. And it was in that moment he saw with new eyes. See, I fully believe when we only focus on being right, we lose sight. When all we do is focus on being right, we lose sight of what God wants us to see and what God wants us to do. But when the body of Christ can look at the person they once thought was wrong and say, brother, sister, God restores our sight. He restores the body of Christ. And then with the community's sight restored, God will reveal what is right for that community at that time and that place. I've seen it here at Joy. This vision statement that welcomes people that we unintentionally exclude, this wasn't done by one or two people. This was done in the context of community as God revealed this to us, what was right and wrong for this time and in this place. And I am proud of all the people, the community, the body of Christ that came together and to do this. And some people will say, well, you're wrong. I know you're wrong. And I'm going to say, I'll tell you what, we did it in faith in the context of community. When we focus on being right, we lose sight. But with God's help, we are given new eyes to see beyond the politics and positions and see our brothers and our sisters. What do I want to be when I grow up? In community. With my brothers and sisters in Christ. I want to close today with this poem. It was written by Teresa Oavilla in the 1500s. But I think it speaks to the power of the body of Christ when we give up being right and wrong and let God change us and call each other brother and sister.
Christ has no body. But yours. No hands, no feet on earth, but yours. Yours are the eyes with which he looks compassion on this world. Yours are the feet with which he walks to do good. Yours are the hands with which he blesses all the world. Yours are the hands, yours are the feet. Yours are the eyes, you are his body. Christ has no body now but yours. No hands, no feet on earth, but yours. Yours are the eyes with which he looks compassion on this world. Christ has no body now on earth, but yours.
At this time, I'd like to invite you to join us in communion as a tangible reminder of God's grace and the hope that we've received through Jesus Christ. And as we remember Jesus's sacrifice, we remember that Jesus loved all people. Jesus accepted all people. And Jesus sacrificed his life for all people. He always had his arms open wide, especially for those that were marginalized and shunned in his society. And so at Joy, we open our arms wide to all people in acceptance of all. Because on the night in which our Lord Jesus was betrayed, he took bread, gave thanks, broke it, and said, "Take and eat. This is my body given for you. Do this for the remembrance of me. And again, after supper, he took the cup, he gave thanks, and said, this cup is a new covenant in my blood, shed for you and for all people for the forgiveness of sins. Do this for the remembrance of me. Remembering Jesus's life, death, and resurrection, we remember the prayer that Jesus taught us. Let's say that together. Our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come, your will be done on earth as in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread and forgive us our sin as we forgive those who sin against us. Save us from the time of trial and deliver us from evil. For the kingdom, the power, and the glory are yours, now and forever. Amen. Now I invite you with whatever bread and wine or crackers and juice, whatever you have available to remember Jesus' sacrifice, go ahead and take a piece of the bread or cracker. And this is Christ's body given for you. And this is the blood of Christ shed for you. Let's pray. Loving God, we thank you for this meal and the reminder that you love us and accept us for who we are. Thank you for demonstrating sacrificial love for all people. Help us to love and sacrifice not just for those who look like us or have the same beliefs, but also for those who are very different from us. Guide us to reach out to those who are shunned and marginalized in our community, to reflect Jesus's command to love one another as I have loved you. In Jesus's name we pray. Amen.
Hi, Joy family. We have some exciting news to share with you today.
We are the 12 members in the search for the new youth director.
The team's been meeting since January. Our first few meetings, they were in person, but the rest of our work had to continue virtually.
We wrote an elevator pitch and talked about what was most important in a new youth director and revised the job description.
The job was posted with the Synod, at local and regional colleges, and on job boards.
We received 21 applications, and a small group conducted pre-screen interviews with 11 of those candidates.
Of those 11 individuals, 4 moved on to team interviews.
References were contacted, and we did a background check.
He toured our building while wearing a mask, met with staff, and talked with some of our youth.
With the help of counsel, HR, and the finance team, an offer was prepared.
God sent us an individual who is a perfect fit for Joy. He sent us someone who is passionate about reaching youth wherever they are and helping them grow closer to God in a fun, relational setting.
It took many hours of Zoom meetings, but we figured out how to complete this task without personal contact. It took 6 months, and all I want to say is God is good. I am grateful to this team for their dedication and effort. Please meet our new youth director, Nick Nally, and his wife, Holly.
Hey, everyone. It's me. I've heard that some of you weren't sure if I was a real person or not because there's a pixelated version of me floating around some emails and stuff. So I figured I'd show you my college cardboard cutout version of me first. But he's a little tired, so he's going to go take a nap. So we'll just keep him over there. But I'm so glad to be a part of the Joy family. My name is Nick Nally. I'm going to be the new youth director for Joy Lutheran Church. At the time of recording this video, I'm actually in my last week with my current church over in McHenry before I make the trek over to Joy pretty soon. And my official start date is going to be Monday, June 22nd. And so that's coming up real soon. And so my family and I are very, very excited to become a part of this new family. And Everything that I've been hearing and learning so far is nothing but amazing. I am so ecstatic to be a part of this family, and I feel like we're going to fit right in. And just to tell you a little bit about myself, I'm a huge fan of dad jokes. I'm a huge geek at heart, definitely, you know, a dorky kid at heart that's never really fully grown up, but hey, maybe we're not supposed to. I love working with students, though. And one of my biggest joys in life is just seeing students from junior high and high school stepping into a more fuller, truer version of who God has been shaping them to be and who they've been destined to be all along, and really owning themselves as a child of God, and owning the voice that God has been entrusting them with, that he's given them. And I personally believe that everyone has a voice that's worth being heard, and that's kind of been my mantra lately, and that's what I want to communicate to our students in whatever fun, crazy ways work best. So I'm excited to partner with you guys. I'm so excited to work over at Joy. What I'd like to do, though, is I'd like to also introduce you to my other half, to my wife and our puppy, Desi. So we're going to do a little bit of a drum roll here. You guys ready? Those of you on camera, let's do a drum roll. Let's go. And introducing the other half, Mrs. Holly Nelly. There she is.
Hi, I'm Holly.
It's our little paparoo, Desi. She's a big baby. She's about 6 months old. But Holly and I are both living in McHenry, Illinois. Mm-hmm. And pretty soon we'll be making the trek over to Gurnee to join our new church family over there with you guys, whether it's online for a little while like this or whether it's in person, hopefully sooner than later. Mm-hmm. But we're very excited to get to be a part of this new family. All of you students out there, I'm especially excited to get to know you in whatever ways work best, whether we have to do it over Zoom or with masks on, whatever it takes, I'm game. You know, I'm in this for you guys, so I'm very excited to get to know you. Could not be happier about where God has placed us in this season. We feel like this is exactly where he wants us to belong. Mm-hmm. And we're right at home, and we're excited to get to know this new home. So
yeah.
We love you guys. We're excited to get to know you. Thanks so much. Our dog, Desi, keeps on ringing the bell because she really wants to go outside. It's such a beautiful day today. So get outside, enjoy the sun. We'll see you soon.
Bye.
We gotta let the light shine. We are the light, we are the light, we are the light.
Let your light shine brighter.
We are the light, we are the light, we are the light.
Jesus,
you are the light, you are the light, you are the light.
We will lift you high and
shine, shine, shine. We are the light of the world. We are the city on a hill. We are the light of the world. We gotta, we gotta, we gotta let the light shine. We are the light of the world. We are the city on a hill. We are the light of the world. We gotta, we gotta, we gotta let the light shine.
Let the light shine, let the light shine. Let the light shine, let the light shine.
Well, Joy, it was so good to be with you this week, especially for those of you who are newer to Joy. Thank you for joining us. We are glad you are part of this community. And to be honest with you, when I talked about being the body of Christ, we consider you part of this body, and so we hope to continue to engage with you and get to meet you and get to learn with you and beside you and together. And so with that, why don't you help me with the benediction? May we reach our neighbors with Christ's love so all lives are changed. And all God's people agreed and said, amen. We will see you next week.